I know you guys don't have words, but you can go ahead and sing along these songs with us. You'll know this one too.
If you have your Bibles, turn to Matthew chapter 27. In preparing this today, this was supposed to be one message, and it's just not going to happen. And so I'm going to have to complete this Sunday morning. There are some notes there on the chair. And also, if you're watching on Facebook, you can also print those off of Facebook. I'm going to talk about something today called the providence of God. If you can look at Scripture and you can see that God is not involved in His creation and He is not sovereign in His creation, then you're going to have to continue to look. We're going to see things that happened from 700 years ago that God providentially planned in all of His way. And we're going to definitely see this in this passage of Scripture in Matthew. But before we get there, I want to talk about a few things. I want to talk about providence. I want to talk about sovereignty. I want to talk about something that truly I don't think you and I will ever be able to wrap our hands around and understand in our finite minds, how God at the beginning of time predetermined everything that was going to take place and how we play out in this. Sunday morning, I'm also going to discuss how prayer and providence play into role. Do we even need to pray? Why does He ask us to pray if the providence of God is also going to play a role in that? And so we're going to look at that. Somebody once said this, that I live out my life as providence allows. If providence is this, is the doctrine is summarized in this manner, that God in eternity past, in the counsel of His own will, ordained everything that is going to happen. But yet in no sense is God the author of sin, amen, nor is human responsibility ever removed. If you look up the word providence, people will say this, that it's not in our English Bible whatsoever, or sovereignty is not in our English Bible whatsoever, then that's absolutely true. But the word Bible is not in our English Bible. The word Trinity is not in our English Bible. The word discipleship is not in our English Bible. The word evangelism is not in our English Bible. Exposition is not in our English Bible. Counseling, ethics, politics, or charismatic is not in our English Bible. What ways do we see that God is in complete control? To providence is a Latin word, provide. It means to foresee or to see forward in something. The Heidelberg Catechism in 1563 said this. Listen, 1563 said, "The Almighty, everywhere present power of God, whereby, as it were by His hand, still holds up the heaven and the earth and all the creatures and governs them, the herbs, the grass, the rain, the drought, the fruitful, the barren years, the meat, the drink, the health, the sickness, the riches, the poverty. Indeed, all things come not by chance and not by luck, as a lot of people want to believe. It is coming by the Father's hand." Providence. And when people look at this, the people who doubt providence of God, they're going to doubt it in a couple different ways. The first one is called the Big Bang Theory. They're going to ask, is the universe governed by chance, by luck, or is it governed by providence of God? The Big Bang Theory simply states, it's a guess, a hypothesis that states that the current past matter in the universe came into existence one day, about 13.8 billion years ago, and all of this matter was compacted into a very small ball. And it's with infinite density and intense heat called singularity. Suddenly, singularity began to expand. It blowed up, and then we have the universe as we know it today. Therefore, we believe in the Big Bang, people say. As believers, we say the Genesis 1:1, that in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth, and it was providentially planned long before the earth was made. Then there's other people that struggle with providence because they wonder, how does my free will work into the providence of God and to His plan? There are some people who say that God directly or indirectly orchestrating all things absolutely destroys the possibility of you and I having a free will, and we are like robots being controlled by God. And they say, if God is in complete control, how can you and I truly be free to make the decisions that you and I want to make? In other words, for free will to be meaningful, there must be some things that is going to lie outside God's sovereign control. That's what they think. In order for you and I to have a true free will, God cannot be in control of some things. Therefore, the contingency of human choice overrules God's control. That's a scary thought, is it not? So let's assume that this argument that God is not in control of everything, let's assume it's true. But if God is not in complete control of everything, of all contingencies, of all plans, then how in the world could He ever guarantee our salvation? Philippians 1:6, "He who began a good work in you will carry it on to the completion until the day of Jesus Christ." It is He who is doing the good work in you, but if human contingency has a plan, then you are going to play a role in that, and you're going to take over, and He's going to lose control. If you don't believe God is in control of all things, then the promise of Philippians 1:6 and other divine promises are going to be in doubt now. If the future does not belong completely and utterly to God, then we do not have complete security that our salvation will be made complete. If God is not in control of all things, then He is not sovereign. And if He is not sovereign, then He is no longer what? God. If our free will can trump divine providence, then who is ultimately in control? And it is us. Divine providence does not destroy our freedom. Rather, divine providence takes our freedom into account and in the infinite wisdom of God sets a course to fulfill God's will. I want you to wrap your hands around that. That divine providence does not destroy our free will. Rather, it takes our freedom into account from the very beginning, before the world was ever created. And in the infinite wisdom of God, He sets a course even with our free will, and he designs the providence of God to the end. That's how big God is. What does the Bible say about the providence of God throughout the scriptures? We see the providence of God over the universe. Psalms 103:19, the Lord has established his throne in the heavens and his kingdom rules over all of it. Do you believe that God controls every star in the sky, the entire universe? No matter how big or small we think it is, no matter what we know about it, God is in complete control of everything that happens in the entire universe. Not only this, we see in Matthew 5:45, for he makes his sun to rise on evil and on the good, and he sends rain on the just, and he also sends it on the unjust. He has control over all the weather and over all the earth. Not only this, we're going into an election period. He has it over all the nations. Psalm 66, who rules by his might forever, whose eyes keeps watch on the nations, let not the rebellious exalt themselves. Daniel 2 says, it is he who changes the times and seasons. Is it God who stopped the sun? Is it God who can pause the seasons? It is God who does this. He said he removes the kings and he establishes kings. He gives wisdom to the wise men and knowledge to the men of understanding. We've had great leaders, godly leaders, and we've had people who were not godly leaders and did not stand for Christ. You know who put both of them into office? God did. That does not negate our responsibility to vote and do what we're supposed to do, however. He's also providence over our human destiny. Galatians 1, but when he had set me apart before I was ever born, and he called me by his grace. Then we see he has providence over our human success and also our failures. He has brought down the mighty from their thrones and exalted the humble. Some people will blame Satan when cancer enters into their life. They will blame Satan when bad things, when they blow a tire. I want you to understand something. The devil is God's devil. What do I mean by that? There's nothing the devil is going to do or be able to act or say unless God has approved it. You look at the story of Job. Job had no idea what was happening in the heavens. And God gave him permission to take everything but his life and then take his health but not his life. Job had no understanding, had no idea what was going on. The devil is God's devil. However, in all of this, God does not smile upon sin or have anything to do with it because he is holy. Yet he allows sin and evil into this world. Look at September 11th, when evil destroyed two towers and killed over 3,000 people. How does all of that fit into God's perfect providential plan? Job asked that question, did he not? With his three friends who gave him idiotic advice as they were sitting around him for 7 days, they didn't say the word. That was the best thing they could have done and should have remained doing. And God finally spoke up in the final chapters, and he said, when Job was, why did you allow this to happen? And God quickly reminds him that he is God. He said, were you there when I created the earth? Were you there when I created the animals? Were you there when I created the seas? Do not question me. I am right, and I am just, and I have a plan. But you know what? In all of the book of Job, Job never knows what that plan is. And you and I do not either. We also see over the protection of his children. Psalms 4:8, in peace I will both lie down and sleep for you alone. O Lord, make me to dwell in safety. But also in the providence of God, we're going to see this. Just because we believe God should protect us, does he always protect us in the way that we think he should protect us? When Jesus was at the Garden of Gethsemane, when he was praying, if there's any other way, if there's any other way this cup can pass from me, please let this pass from me. But it's not about me. It's not about my will. It's about yours. And then we see the providence of God when he allowed him to go to the cross and and endure a cruel beating, because this was in God's plan. And I think sometimes we should not ask for necessarily a healing. We should ask that God, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And God, make me okay with that and give me peace with that. That's what I seek. And you're going to see tonight the providence of God, and you're going to see it Sunday morning in Jesus' burial. And if you walk away from any of these final sermons and you say, I just don't believe that God is in control, then I don't know what to tell you from here on out. We're going to begin because the book of Matthew 27 doesn't actually tell the story of the thief's death on the cross. I've actually got this up here for you. John chapter 19 actually tells the end result of what happened with the thieves on the cross and also with the piercing of Jesus. But Matthew doesn't cover it. In John 19:32, he says, so the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first man and of the other who was crucified with him. But coming to Jesus, remember these are Dismas and Gestas. But coming to Jesus, when they saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs, the broken legs. You see, it was the Jews who requested that the legs of the criminals be broken because they had to expedite this. The Sabbath day was coming. And they could no longer push up if their legs were broken due to the broken bones. They did not have, it hurt too bad to push up, and then they lost their strength. Remember, they could live on a cross for several days. It's been proven. It's been documented. And they had to hurry this process along. Remember, it was only 9 a.m. to 3 p.m. when Jesus died. 3 p.m. 6 p.m. starts the new day, the Sabbath day. And you're going to see the providential plan in this. And it says that they did not break his legs. By the way, in Psalms 34:20, the Bible says he keeps all of his bones, and not one of them is broken. David wrote this between 401 BC to 500 BC, hundreds of years before this ever took place. David had already wrote about it, sitting in a cave. David may have been looking at his own arms and saying, and all of this, I haven't broken any bones, but God providentially planned David to write that out, talking about his son. 500 to 600 years before this ever happened, he said, my son will not break any bones. But then one of the soldiers pierced his side with a spear, and immediately blood and water came out of this. Why do you think that soldier didn't break a leg? Why do you think he didn't? He saw that he was dead, but why didn't he just go ahead and break his legs anyway? Because the plan wasn't that he broke the legs. They had a different plan. The soldier didn't know what God's plan was, but he acted on that providential plan. Look what I'm saying. One of the soldiers pierced his side. Zechariah 12:10 says, so they will look at me whom they have what? Pierced. Written 518 BC. It had already been predicted. And then it said blood and water came out. I told you back at the Garden of Gethsemane when I went through this, and I told you that Jesus Christ had a heart attack at that point, or somewhere going to the cross, and I would prove it, and tonight I'm going to prove it. There's such thing as a pericardial effusion. This is a buildup of fluid around the heart. Now, everybody has fluid around their heart. It's a pericardium. It's a small sac that gathers around the heart. It's very thin. There is a little bit of fluid around there. But as you see of the result of the garden experience, and he had such a traumatic event, it was heart attack, stroke-like conditions. A normal heart would look like this on your left. On the left, you see the pericardium. It's just a small sac of fluid around it. But what happens is when somebody is under a deep emotional distress, or somebody has a heart attack, amongst other things, which doesn't fit his scenario, by the way. This huge pocket of fluid gathers around the heart. In fact, Psalm 69:20, reproach has broken my heart, is what the psalmist says. The word reproach would mean the shame, the rejection of the father had broken his heart. It means to tear or to crush into different pieces. And the inflammation of pericardium, of the fluid around the heart, is a result of a heart attack. And so the reason that the water and the blood came out was because Christ had a heart attack either in the garden or on his way to the cross. And when they pierced his side, blood and water came out from the pericardium effusion. What does Psalmist say? He said, "And reproach has broken my heart." Now we're in Matthew. He picks up the rest of this storyline in verse 57. "When it was evening, there came a rich man of Arimathea named Joseph." What an interesting part of the story this is. Now remember, the next day would have been the Sabbath day. If you're wondering how this all fits into play and how this fits in God's providential plan, how many days? What, 3 days, right? The next day started 6 p.m. They only had from 3 p.m. to 6 p.m., maybe it was 4 p.m. to 6 p.m., in order for Jesus to be in the tomb. There was a timeline at this point, a providential timeline that had to be met, but these people didn't know it. And so what had to happen? Jesus had to be in the tomb before 6 p.m. on that Passover day, because the Sabbath day, we have a 3 days, Friday, Saturday, Sunday. He had to be buried on Friday so that prophecy could be fulfilled. He said, when it was evening, 6 p.m. starts the new day, which is a Sabbath day, which would have been Saturday. So this would have been sometime at 3 p.m. when he died, and however how long it took them to break the soldiers' legs, because once Jesus died, and I believe the Sanhedrin saw this, they began to hurry this up by the providential plan of God. And there came a rich man. And let me show you this. This rich man had already been providentially planned 700 years before this event had ever taken place. Let me prove it to you. Look at the revelation of Joseph here. In Isaiah chapter 53, verse 9, it says, "His grave was assigned with the wicked men, yet he was with the rich man in his death, because he had done no violence, nor was there any deceit in his mouth." He's saying that Jesus did not talk back in the midst of all the things that were happening to him. But let's look at the thing. The grave was assigned to the wicked. Is saying this, that he died in between 700 years prior, that he was going to die with wicked men, with criminals. And not only this, there was the ultimate goal, was to place him in a common grave. And I'm going to explain what that is shortly. And then what does it say? Yet, however, God's got a different plan. He says he is with a rich man. The prediction of Joseph being a very wealthy man 700 years prior. I don't know about you, but that gets me excited. That gets me excited to think that God had already looked ahead, and even to the finest detail, I'm going to assign a rich man named Joseph to take care of your burial, because you're not going to be put in a common grave. And then he says, who himself had also become a disciple. It gives us a little more detail about who this Joseph is. It says he was a disciple. Joseph was part of the Sanhedrin, but was discipled or taught by Christ. Let me explain what this word disciple of Christ means. It simply means this. Joseph listened to the teaching of Christ. That's what it means. Now, did he do it up close? Did he follow with the crowds? I think this was Joseph. He was here, and Jesus was there, and Joseph just listened and walked, but he stayed at a distance. That's what that word means. He just heard the teaching of Jesus. But Mark chapter 15 sheds a little more light. At some point, Joseph had decided secretly to be a disciple of Christ, a follower, but he was in a terrible quandary. Mark 15 says, Joseph of Arimathea, a prominent member of the council, Sanhedrin, who himself waiting for the kingdom of God. What do you mean the kingdom of God? Just like everybody else was at the beginning of a week, waving their palm branches, going, Hosanna, 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 here comes the king. He's going to establish his kingdom. Nope, not yet. Joseph Arimathea believed the promise that there was going to be a Messiah coming. And he believed Jesus was the one, and he was waiting for this kingdom. Luke 23 says, and there was a man named Joseph. He was a good and a righteous man. And Joseph Arimathea watched all these things transpire. And in John 19:38, I'm going to skip there because it fills in the blank where Matthew does. And after these things, Joseph Arimathea, being a disciple of Jesus, secret one for fear of the Jews, asked Pilate that he might take away the body of Jesus. And Pilate granted permission, so he came and took away his body. Listen to this. He was a secret follower because of the fear. He was secretly listening, secret follower. He wasn't, hey, I'm going to be like the disciples and I'm going to show you and I'm going to walk with you. He was secretly following after Jesus Christ. And this is what happened. He went before Pilate, which is a big deal, by the way. He reached the point in his life where he didn't care what anyone thought any longer. Because when he went to Pilate, he had to go into the praetorium. Do you remember when the Sanhedrin took Jesus to the praetorium? What did they do? They stood back at a distance. Joseph of Arimathea walked into the praetorium and said, I would like to have Jesus' body. What did he do? We're going to find out. He completely defiled himself for the Sabbath. You know why Joseph of Arimathea reached a point in his life where I don't care what anybody thinks anymore? It's something switched in him where he saw the wickedness that was done and he changed. And so he asked for this body. Now we're back in Matthew 27:58. The man went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Pilate ordered it to be given to him. To him is not in the earliest manuscripts. That's why it's in brackets. Pilate ordered this. This is interesting. What would happen to a crucified body? You know, crucifixions, you would have to do something in order to be crucified, an enemy of the state, so to speak. Crimes against the state. So what would happen to a normal crucified body if Joseph wouldn't have asked for it? Well, generally, it would be given to the family or family member. But if it was somebody who was crucified, they would not even allow the family to take the body and give it a proper burial. The Romans would take care of this. This was amazing that Joseph got the body of Jesus Christ that a family member did not, which probably wasn't going to happen, but also it wasn't buried into a common grave. I mean, it would have been buried into a common grave. Why did Joseph get the body? Well, besides the providential plan of God, why did Joseph get the body? It's because I believe Pilate was already scared of the Sanhedrin, and he probably thought when he got there, good, I'll give it to you. Y'all just take care of it. You know what? He didn't ask questions. He didn't say, what you going to do with it? Are you going to mutilate it anymore? You going to cut it up into pieces? What are you going to do? You know what? He didn't care. He was already scared of the Sanhedrin enough. I think he also could have been thinking that Joseph was speaking for the entire council. He was glad to get rid of this body. Now, what would have normally happened to the bodies? They would have been dumped in a burning open grave. Many of you remember this. You'll think, oh yeah, I've heard about this. This is a 2015 picture of the Hinnom Valley. This would have been the trash dump. This is the southwest border of the ancient Jerusalem, stretches from the foot of Mount Zion to the Kidron Valley. It's actually first mentioned in the book of Joshua, not as a good place. It's a garbage dump and outside the walls of Jerusalem, and there would be a fire that would be constantly burning to keep the stench down. But it would also be the location that bodies were thrown of criminals, those who had been executed and denied proper burial by Rome. The reason they would do this is to prove a point, even in the burial, stop sinning, lying, trespassing against Rome. Here's going to be your result. And they throw it. Can you imagine what the smell must have been like with the burning bodies? This would have been the fate of Jesus. But God, 700 years prior, providentially planned, that's not the way my son will be buried. By the way, this place right here is always known for its evil. It's the place of religious child sacrifice by Moloch, by the Canaanites outside the city. And then we move on. In Matthew 27:59, and Joseph took the body. Joseph took, it means this. It means he carried it himself. It is a specific Greek word, to carry it himself. Now, Joseph is moving very quickly. Is it because he was violating the Sabbath? He was trying to get Jesus buried into his tomb. So he grabs up the body. He don't say anybody else helps him, not the word, the Greek word that is used. Is he afraid that the violation of the Sabbath, or he didn't want to defile himself? And as I've already said, when he walked into the praetorium, he had already defiled himself for the Sabbath, but he's moving quickly. He took the body of Jesus. Was he afraid that in one of the Sanhedrin were going to see him? Is this the whole reason that he was so moving so quickly? And I think Joseph moved quickly because God providentially planned for Joseph to move quickly and put the urgency in his heart. Look at Matthew 12:40. For just as Jonah was 3 days and three nights in the belly of the sea monster, so will the Son of Man be 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth. You know why Joseph was hurrying? Because he was on God's providential timeline. And he was moving quickly. God had already placed it into his heart to move, to move, to move. He picked him up himself and was carrying him away. And what did he do with the body? And I'm almost done. Then we're going to look at the women who were there and what happened Sunday morning. And he wrapped it in a clean linen cloth. He was, at this point, he was no longer alone in preparing the body. The Bible says in John 19:39 that another man from Sanhedrin called Nicodemus, he began to bring myrrh and aloes and 100 pounds of spice and weight to conceal the body odor. This preparation of the body. Now, it's amazing that these men must have gotten together at some point, but Nicodemus now is follower after Jesus Christ. I think probably not ready to stand out like Joseph did, but he was following him. And Nicodemus was very wealthy. I want to show you this with the grave, with the spices. It has been said that Nicodemus spent $100,000. And all the spices and the myrrh and the aloes in order for Jesus to have the proper burial. He didn't spare any cost. I do think this. Maybe they didn't know. Maybe they were looking. They knew that he would return. Maybe they knew he was the Messiah. He was going to establish his kingdom. I often think, would if Nicodemus knew that he was going to be raised in 3 days, would he have spent $100,000 on everything that he did? Or did he know and it didn't matter? I don't know. I think it's interesting that we have disciples that openly, during his lifetime, walked with him, ran away at the end, and there's two men who secretly followed and in the end came forward publicly to give him the appropriate burial, and his disciples were nowhere to be found. And the last verse we're going to look at tonight, and he laid it in his own tomb, new tomb, that he had hewn out of the rock and rolled a large stone against the entrance in the tomb and went away. He said that this is a tomb that he owned, the new tomb, and then he took this large stone, and this was to keep animals from desecrating the body of Christ. He wasn't thinking about anybody stealing it. It was just to, it wasn't till later on we're going to see it was the Sanhedrin who came up with this crazy, somebody's going to steal the body. But he did it to keep animals from desecrating the body and rolled the stone in front of it. I want us to take a gander and look at these things today from the very beginning that we've seen from the garden and on. Today's lesson is about the providence of God and God already foreknowing and foretelling everything that was going to take place. He had decided up to 700 years and foretold it, but knew it. Do you not think that God is in complete control of everything that goes in and on and around our lives? Father, we love you. We thank you for this time. God, even in the very difficult situations that we go through, we pray this, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. We pray you have a good evening.